Hello, good day, and I hope you are doing well. Today's topic is important points to be considered for casting vendor. Let us see. First, let us see what are the general points. When was the foundry established? What is its experience in valve industry? And what is the background of top management? This is first that you must check when the foundry was established, because if it is a new foundry, it will not have experience to produce a complex casting such as valve bodies or pressure retaining components. So it's better that you should not select such vendors because you will have problems for the future. Second, you must understand that what are the components they have produced already. If they have not produced any of the component, try to give components which are non-pressure retaining, so that they will get some experience and they will understand what is the company requirement. If they have produced pressure retaining components, then we can go ahead and give some more pressure retaining components, but in a stepwise manner. Suppose if they have produced an 8-inch body, you cannot give them a 20-inch body or something like that. You can start with 8-inch or 10-inch or something like that. You know, if they produce 150 rating, you cannot ask them to produce 1500 rating valve body, because the thickness changes, so the complete methodology of producing the casting is changed. So that point we have to remember. And third, what is the background of the top management? Are they technical people, are they commercial people, or are they from different background and then they have just come into foundry because they see that okay, there is some profit or some benefits. So one has to consider what is the top management background. If they are technocrats, it's very good. You can take a chance and you can give them some work. But if they are not from technical background, it's better that you try to stay away from them, because it might happen that the top management just open because for the sake of. If you feel and if you're not comfortable in any of these points, it's better that you don't go with these companies. Next, check the developed components both in as-cast and machined conditions. Check its complete documentation and its development time. Here what I mean to say is that you can consider a case study. Suppose if they have done a valve body or some development they have done, so you can see what they have done, actual photographs or documentation in terms of dimensional reports of as-cast, and if they have supplied machined, then you can ask for a dimensional report of the machined casting, and then you can understand that how they are able to do the development. You can also take a note of the development time that they have taken for such components. Methoding is also equally important here. You can see, you can verify and check whether how they are doing the methoding. Third, check the HSE policy and its implementation. Here there are two parts. One is policy and implementation. When we talk about policy, it could be at the documentation level. So they have done all the documentation, but however, implementation is not done. So you need to go and verify and check whether they have implemented the system which they are referring to. I'll show you a small video to see how HSE can affect.
Thank you.
Here you have seen in the video, all the norms of HSE are broken. There is no health and safety. There are environmental issues. You know, people are pouring liquid metal without any safety shoes or goggles or proper clothes. And also, if you can see that the fumes which are coming from the liquid metal are being just inhaled by those people. So these are major issues actually, and from such foundries you have to stay away. Next, check the foundry shop floor and its different areas. Here you just have to go and see what kind of health and safety precautions they are taking at different areas. You know, for example, you can go on the shop floor and see how tidy it is. You can go in the melting area to see where the slag is being kept, or how they manage the slag, or how they are keeping the ferroalloys. You can go in the cutting areas to see that are proper work benches are available, how fettling is being done. All these things, visual view of the complete foundry has to be taken considered. Another point, check the number of employees and the level of automation. Here you will see in any department that number of people and the level of automation. For example, let us consider a scenario where in melting there are number of people and there is no automation. Everything is done manually. So if that is a scenario, you will understand that there are a lot of parameters that are changing or waving due to manpower involvement. So that has to be minimized if you are able to produce a good casting, especially fettling, where number of people are very high and level of automation is almost zero. Here also you will see that even though there are two same components, but when they go through fettling through different workers, it might produce a different casting. So one has to see what is the level of number of workers and the level of automation. I'll give you a simple example, you know, where a scenario happened that castings were not delivered on time and they were in fettling for a long 2 to 3 weeks time. When I checked with our planning department, we understand that, you know, the fettling department operators are not coming and hence the work was stuck. So you have to understand that as the number of people increases, your dependency on them increases, plus chances of error increases manifold. So make sure that you check this point before you go ahead. Mostly all the critical operations has to be verified that there has to be some level of automation. Check the pattern, die storage area and its retrieval system. This is again an important point, because if the retrieval system is not proper, you might produce a wrong casting at the end of the day. Also, patterns are normally made of wood, so storage and its care has to be taken so that you have the same casting after 3 months or 6 months and so. So this area has to be checked before you go for the next. Check for proper lighting, ventilation and escape path. This is again an important point, because lot of foundries you might have gone and seen that there are no proper lighting or there is no proper ventilation for air. Also, emergency paths are not available. Imagine if something happens and then evacuation has to be done. So this point has to be considered. Check for all ISO documentation, involvement of top management and measure and control parameters. Here ISO documentation is done for the sake of getting the certificate, but please make sure that it has been implemented thoroughly, and you need to check and verify that all the points which are there in ISO are being practiced in the shop floor. Also, try to check the involvement of top management in implementing ISO at the shop floor. Third point is that measure and control parameters. Here in any foundry, there are roughly 50 plus parameters. That is one of the reasons that, you know, you get a casting at the same component with different results, because there are so many parameters and you have to understand that how many parameters they have been measuring. The more parameters they are measuring, it means the more parameters they have to control. here the cost may go high. So you must understand that how many parameters they are measuring and how many they are controlling. If the parameters are less, then there is a chance that your casting may not come as per your requirement. So try to see they are covering major parameters and controlling them as per your requirement. Now let us see what are the points that we have to consider while they are in design stage. First, here what we are discussing are the points which are only applicable for pressure containing parts like body, bonnet, end piece, connectors, covers, stem housing, etc. I am not going to cover the simple casting because those we can produce it simple and you don't need much engineering. I mean, you need a little bit of engineering, but not as much as for pressure containing part. So all these points are applicable mostly for pressure containing parts. Also, try to check that whether the supply of casting is in as cast or machine condition. This condition must be established because if you are taking the as cast casting from the foundry, then you have to check whether all the parameters that you are required are being matched by the casting by the foundry or not. And if they are in machine condition, then you just have to check whether all the critical dimensions are being machined as per the drawing. Also, understand the tolerance required by you, the tolerance achieved by the process and the foundry. Here there are three important points. First, what is the tolerance required by you? Are these tolerances can be achieved by casting process or do you need to do machining? That is first point. Second, try to understand what is the tolerance achieved by a casting process. There are a lot of foundries which will tell that they can do CT7 grade, but at the end of the day they are doing CT9 or CT10. So you have to understand that what is the level of process. For example, in sandcasting, if you try to do a CT7, it is not possible. While if you want CT9 or CT10 investment casting, it can be done easily. Also, check for the foundry whether they have experience or not. Many times it happens that a foundry, that is the reason I said that you need to check the foundries established for a good number of years, because the tolerances and this are based on the foundry experience. So an investment casting with 10 years plus experience, they can achieve CT7 because they have worked around to find out all the parameters and they are controlling all the parameters for wax and coating and even the drying. So they are able to achieve that CT7 tolerances. While if the foundry is new, they will not be achieve such tight tolerances. Also check for geometrical tolerances and also check how they are going to measure it. What is the establishment of inspection? This is critical because many times it happens that they will do everything and then they are not able to measure some very, very critical dimensions. So make sure that all the geometrical tolerances as well as linear tolerances are measured and established. Next point is simulation software for casting, pouring and solidification available with the vendor? Software output must be reviewed and must be followed in the actual casting. Here this point is again important, that do they have a simulation software with them? If they don't have it, then they are using a trial and error method where they are just pouring and trying to see that what is the result. So be careful with such foundries. Also, there are a lot of investment casting foundries where they try to do a methoding, but they simply glue to a straight tree and then they say this is the methoding, but this is not done. Methoding is a science, is a completely different science where you need lot of engineering and trial and error, which can be done by simulation, but you need to understand that how many risers are required, what are the runners, what are the hot spots, what are the feeding distance to be given, what should be the size of the riser, and all these things has to be calculated before you do any trial or you make any sample. If you do an error in this case, then you are wasting time at least of 2 to 3 weeks again, especially in investment casting. So, or otherwise you just have to repair and give it to the customer and say this is a sample, but At the end of the day, you know that you have not done a good job for methoding. So you have to understand that there has to be a simulation software available with them. There are a lot of people who will say that, you know, we have 15 years or 20 years of experience with methoding and we have done so many components similar to this. So we are very comfortable and we can give you the casting. I'm sure those castings will take a lot of time, because once if you don't establish the methoding, it's not that simple as it appears. So make sure that simulation softwares are available. RT level 2 or better should be targeted for samples, and with the casting area to be considered as 100%, and level 2 or level 3 as per B16.34 for critical area at production stage. Now again, this is important point, because if you are not going to consider this point and if you start doing your methoding, it might happen that you do a methoding for level 3 and then the customer is asking for level 2. So it's better that you establish that what level of defects are allowed in the casting, both at sample as well as production level. By doing this, you know, you will be taking care in the methoding, and then the same will be followed at the shop floor. So RT level is very, very important to be established in the design stage itself. Next is how improvement in the yield can be done. Yield is an important parameter which actually governs the cost of the foundry. So higher the yield, the lesser is the cost and more benefit to the foundry. So each foundry will try to increase the yield of the production. However, at the sample stage, you can have an yield of say 30 or 40, but in the production, you try to increase the yield, thereby trying to maximize your profit. But in doing so, it might happen that there are a lot of defects in the casting and the production stage. So one must understand that they will improve it, but how they are going to improve it? Are they going to use simulation, or are they going to use some other methods for improving the yield? Next, heat treatment. This process is the most important process. First, heat treatment must be in-house. Applicable ASTM standards must be followed. If the heat treatment is not in-house, then there could be a chances that the heat treatment of the casting is not done properly. It has to be in-house and it has to be done in a controlled manner. That is one of the main reasons that it should be in-house. Another point which one has to consider is that the water that you can use for quenching, the pH value has to be between 7 and 7.5, and the chloride content should be max 25 ppm. This is required because the chloride content or the water might attack the SS castings. Next, heat treatment cycle must be established and approved before heat treatment is done. First, heat treatment cycle must be witnessed. Again, this is important. As I said, that heat treatment is the most important process. Hence, it is ideal that one should witness the first heat treatment cycle and also establish that how they are going to do the heat treatment of the casting. Another point to consider is stacking of parts, which should not affect the geometry or induce stress on the casting. Stacking program must be reviewed. How they are stacking the component on each other during the, you must review it before they do anything on that. Next, WCC is normalized or quenched and tempered if impact test is required. LCB, LCC is quenched and tempered. Third, CFA time or other stainless steel materials is solution annealed. Transfer time for quenching is 60 seconds max. Temperature of quenching media can be raised only by 10 degrees centigrade. Agitation system must be in place. You must check that whether they have an agitation system or they just have a mechanical fan. So this is very important. And the temperature should not raise by more than 10 degrees centigrade. It means that when the quenching is done, the heat of transfer must be done in a very controlled and smooth manner. If you do a shock treatment for the casting, the stress will be induced much higher and there could be a chance that the casting will fail at the testing time. So the heat transfer, the removal of heat must be done in a steady and uniform manner. Rate of heating must be 150 degrees centigrade per hour, and furnace loading temperature must be 300 degrees centigrade. This is again important because if you try to raise the heat much higher, then there could be a chance that the heat treatment is not done properly, and if you try to introduce the casting at a much higher temperature then 300 degrees centigrade, there could be a chance that stresses are induced due to huge temperature difference. Volume of quench must be at least 20 times as compared to furnace capacity. Heat treatment graph must be generated automatically, and it should be linked, or there has to be some traceability. Now it happens many times that heat treatment graphs are being generated by either using Excel or manual process, but that should not be the case. You should check and verify the heat treatment graphs are being generated through automatic process, through chart recorder, or automatically in the through a PLC in the computer straight away. This is important and it helps you for your documentation, and it might also be required to we have to submit it to our end user or customer. Next, inspection. Analysis of chemical properties, mechanical properties must be done for each heat. It happened that in one time there were three heats put in one furnace load, and then the test bar was only for one heat. It is absolutely wrong. The argument was that since the material is same, the heat treatment cycle is same, the results of will be same. So you can use the same test bar of from one heat to the another two heats. It is absolutely wrong. And you should check if they are doing such kind of practices, you must stop them doing it. Next, 100% visual inspection. Make sure that the casting are checked for 100% visual inspection by the foundry. If not, you have to put a point in the PO that it has to be 100% visual inspection. Wall thickness is to be checked thoroughly. Through and no deviation is allowed. You can see even in the drawing that they will normally put on the positive side, but they will not put any tolerances on the negative side. So wall thickness is mandatory. It has to be checked, and it has to be thoroughly checked through ultrasonic gauges or piston caliper or some other means, but there should not be any deviation for the lower side. Next, all critical dimension to be checked on all the casting. It is mandatory. Mostly 10% of the castings have been checked, which is absolutely not acceptable. Many times it happens that even in the S-cast condition, they are just taking one or two casting out of the lot. That should not be the case. Tell them that you can ask for some more money, you can pay some more money, but make sure that all the casting have been checked, at least for the critical dimensions. Face to face, thickness, flange thicknesses, all those dimensions are to be checked thoroughly. Elevation short of RT is not allowed, and single wall single image is required for sample. Try to see that RT, when they do the RT, such manipulation should not be done. Test bar should be kept at least for 1 year, and you must check where it has been stored and how the traceability has been maintained. Next, check whether fettling is done in-house or is been outsourced to contractors. Establish the communication. Here, many times it happens that since the communication is not been established properly, fettling is been done in such a manner that it might happen that thickness variations are observed. So, communication in terms of a fettling plan or a fettling map is to be provided for each component. Also, ideally it should be preferred in-house. Next, repair of castings. Welding and welding procedures are to be qualified as per ASME section 9, and documents are to be approved by third party inspector. Again, this is important because if the welding is not been approved, there could be a chance that but even after repair there are defects inside welding. Now no major weld is allowed. What do you mean by major weld? It means that if the repair is more than 65 centimeter square, or the repair is more than 20% of the thickness of the valve, or 1 inch, whichever is less, or if there is a crack, such are considered as major weld. And if that is the scenario, then you straight away reject the casting. Minor weld is allowed with permission. Post weld heat treatment is required, and sketch of repair has to be produced or reported. Suitable entity has to be done to check that the defects which are there are being removed. Use of suitable welding rods are to be considered, must be low hydrogen and must be baked before use. Next, calibration. Here, as I said, that there are a lot of parameters which needs to be measured and controlled, and calibration plays an important role in helping us to give us a good casting. First, all the machines like UTM, impact machine, hardness testing machine must be calibrated at least once a year. Thermocouple, temperature recorder, indicators, controller, props must be calibrated once in 3 months, irrespective of its uses. Now, many times it happens that the heat treatment furnace will not be used regularly, and there could be a chance that after 3 months they don't want to do the calibration. But that should not be the case. Irrespective of whether they use it once or they use it daily, it has to be calibrated every 3 months. The reason is that the thermocouples and the temperature sensing elements, they might be affected due to the environmental conditions. So you need to calibrate every 3 months to get a good results. Holding oven and welding machine ammeter must be calibrated every 6 months. Spectrometer must be calibrated by the manufacturer once in a year, and must be calibrated by CRM, that is certified reference material, every time when you on the machine. Heat treatment furnace must be calibrated as per API 6A Appendix M once in a year, irrespective of its use. Other instruments must be calibrated as per instrument manufacturer recommendations. Calibration plan is a must. If you don't have a calibration plan, there could be a chance that you are using the instrument which are not calibrated and might give you a wrong reading, thereby giving you a defective casting. So make sure that a calibration plan is in place. Testing. Here is a list of testing that has to be established either in-house or by external source or an external vendor. It is important because it might happen that you have to go and you have to visit those sub vendors also to see whether they are following all the required procedures and important standards. So it's better that you establish the vendors for all these testings. Documentation from casting vendor for sample. First, material test certificates, reports and its backup documents. Here, all the documents that are there which are used to prepare the material test certificate should be available for verification and should be a part of the sample documentation file. Next. Second, dimensional report along with calibration report of the instrument use. Also check if CMM can be done. Many times it happens that the CMM may not be done for casting as cast because the surface is rough and may damage the probe of this CMM, but for machining component it should be a must. Next, NDD reports with the RT films and shooting sketch must be submitted. Methoding of the casting, simulation output, that is method card, and actual control parameter reports must be submitted. Here, actual control parameter means what is the pouring temperature, what is the time required for a pour, both in the simulation and actual values must be reported. Other reports as required, There could be a plating report, there could be a hydro testing report. All these reports are to be submitted for sample. Let me show you a small video before we finish this session. Here you can see the leakage in the ball valve. What can be done? We can disassemble the valve, remove the and do the welding on it, and try to again assemble and try to check for any leakage. But the problem is that the dimensions, the machining dimensions may affect due to the welding heat. So really it will be a trouble if you try to do such things. Instead, try to check all these points which we have discussed here. Try to discuss with the foundry that try not to select the lowest price and go with them straight away, because those who are the people who will be doing a lot of shortcuts and producing castings where you will have trouble at a later stage. So verify all the parameters have been checked, they have been controlled, and they have been handled by the foundry. If that is the case, then you know you will be producing valves, which is your focus, rather than doing repairs and going and wasting time. Next. So thank you for watching the video. My contact details are here. Apart from this, also note that I am working as consultant for casting development. So if you have any casting which needs to be developed, you can send it across to me, and I'll make sure that the casting have been developed and are been ready for assemble to you. Thank you.